Welcome to the Philadelphia Museum of Art and a special occasion tonight. It's going to be a wonderful treat to hear a brand new commission suite by this gentleman sitting right behind me, Tom Lawton. Give it up for Tom. You know, I was thinking what I'll do, and this way, you know, we can get right to the music. I'll introduce the musicians for you so you can know who's playing tonight. You know about Tom, right? All right? Young lady on violin is Miss Diane Monroe. On trombone, that's John Swana. On the saxophones over there, it's Mr. Ben Schachter. On the bass, Lee Smith. And on the drum kit, give it up for Dan Monaghan. I'm Jeff Duper, I'm with WRTI, and I want to let you know that this is a collaboration between the Philadelphia Museum of Art and the Philadelphia Jazz Project. And that's one of the things I really appreciate about Philadelphia right now, because the Philadelphia jazz community is coming together and collaborating and developing programs that I think you'll enjoy. So just keep in touch with our community, because we have a lot of things going on. And I'd like to bring out one of the gentlemen who is extremely involved in the Philadelphia jazz community, and he's the director of the Philadelphia Jazz Project. Please give a hand for Mr. Homer Jackson.
Good evening. Good evening. Thank you all for coming. It's supposed to be raining, cats, dogs, and other things out there, right? Thank you all for coming. How do we start? First, the Philadelphia Jazz Project, you can think of us as a sort of stimulus project, a stimulus package for jazz in Philadelphia to develop new projects, new ideas, and to outreach to get new audience members to come and check out this music. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Now, we're a sponsored project of the Cultural Works Greater Philadelphia, and we have funding provided by the Winco Foundation. It's really important to thank the folks who make this all possible, so can we give them a hand? I am not a musician. I'm actually a visual artist, and as a teenager, the Philadelphia Museum of Art made the mistake of allowing me into the Duchamp collection. Looking at the Duchamp work blew my mind. And Marcel Duchamp, one of the major architects of modern art, blew my mind. And one of the things about Duchamp's work was that always close by was this other cat, Man Ray. Who is this Man Ray dude? So as a teenager, when I found out that this Man Ray dude, who is like, he's like Scottie Pippen to Michael Jordan, if you look at Duchamp as Jordan, the second man, you know? And when I found out the second man in modern art is from Philadelphia, born and raised here in Philadelphia, my mind was totally blown. So when we sat down and talked about what could we do as a collaboration, the first thing that came to my mind was Man Ray. This guy impacted the world in terms of painting, sculpture, and most important, photography. Photography. Many of his ideas, we actually don't even see his ideas. We see other people who copied his ideas in fashion photography. He is a major force, and it amazes me that we don't have a street named after him in our city. So to start, let's give him a hand. So Tom Lawton felt much like I did about these same things, and the more he did research on this project, the more he saw things about his own career, his own path, that were very similar to Man Ray. So it, as an artist myself, we connected with this man who gave the world so much that we actually don't recognize how much he's actually done. So this is a great opportunity for us to celebrate ourselves as Philadelphians and to celebrate this gentleman who's from this community as well. And to tell us a little bit more about both Man Ray and Tom Lawton, John Vick.
Hello everyone, good evening. My name is John Vick. I'm a project assistant curator here at the museum. I have the pleasure of working with our modern collection. That includes all the Duchamp works that we have down there at the end of the galleries, as well as a lot of other artists, from Europeans like Picasso to Americans like Jackson Pollock, and people like Duchamp or Man Ray who crisscrossed the Atlantic throughout their career. Tom and I met each other a year ago next Friday. He came in to talk about Man Ray, to talk about this collaboration. We talked about Man Ray as this incredibly talented artist with a lot of range, someone who is a painter, a sculptor, a photographer, and I don't think you mentioned it, but an experimental filmmaker as well. Someone who really had a lot to do, someone who was involved with lots of great and important movements of the early 20th century as well. And he also had a lot of range as a traveler. He was from Philadelphia, but he spent a lot of time in New York in the teens, Paris in the 20s and 30s, back to New York in the 40s, Hollywood in the 50s, and then in the 60s back to Paris where he lived out the rest of his life. So Tom and I talked about this when he came in. This was the first of two visits Tom did, with me at least. The other, he came to our study gallery where you can look and works on paper firsthand. That's actually something that's open to the general public if you're interested. And we started really by just looking at some of the works that are on view by Man Ray throughout the museum. So if you were to go down this hallway, turn to the right of the rotunda, go into our Surrealism Gallery, you'd find this great big painting called Fair Weather. It's a painting that Man Ray did. It has these two figures on either side of a door. It's dreamy, it's about fantasy, it's also a little bit of a self-portrait. He did that painting in 1939 at the end of his first stint in Paris, before he came back to the United States, like a lot of artists did as the Second World War was breaking out. It's a really fantastic painting. Man Ray described it as the pinnacle of his surrealist career. And we started there and then we sort of worked our way backwards. We went to these small little sculptures that Man Ray did in the early 1920s when he first arrived in Paris, when he was running around with sort of like a gang, a group of artists affiliated with the Dada movement, very radical anti-establishment group of artists. He made these little sculptures that, you know, you'll see some images up here, where he's taking objects that he finds and combines them. So tacks attached to an iron, the image of an eyeball attached to a metronome, very appropriate for tonight. These are things he eventually allowed to be lost, or he purposely destroyed, only to then remake them 40 years later when he's older in life, right? We don't have those on view right now, actually, because they are getting ready to be included in the Still Life show that's opening in 2 weeks. So if you come back, you'll see some of those works. And then Tom and I went even further back at Man Ray's history to the teens, when Man Ray is in New York, when he's first getting his taste of modern art. He's looking at Cubist artists like Picasso, and he's making his own Cubist paintings and compositions. There's this great work all the way at the end. You think the Surrealism Gallery is at the end, but if you go all the way to the end, past where all the Brancusi sculptures are, and off to the left, we have this great little gallery of New York Dada art for the teens. And in there is this great painting and a sculpture by Man Ray. The painting is called AD 1914, and it shows these figures and horses marching across the canvas. It's a painting about war, but it's also about the progress of the avant-garde, the progress of modernism. And it's a great work. Now, we didn't go back in time any further than that, because if you did, you would find Man Ray before he was even an artist. And as we said before, you wouldn't find him in New York or Hollywood or Paris, but you'd find him here in Philadelphia, because that was his beginning. So, we're going to begin with that. Tom? Ready? Great. Thank you, everyone.
Four. very much.